We have a missing microphone again because Kyle and Greta are gone, and most of you know Greta pretty much runs this church. So anything that works on a Sunday like this is a big win. Mercedes did a great job, but I don't know if any guys even want to come to church, so take that. Hey, welcome. We are very glad that you're here with us today. If you're visiting for the first time, we always make it a really important point. We always highlight the fact that we're just a tiny piece of a very diverse amoeba of the body of Christ around the world, this living thing that looks beautifully different everywhere. And we really love praying for our brothers and sisters in this town as an act of solidarity and unity. And so today we're going to pray for a church that we love dearly and haven't prayed for in a while, the Flagstaff Christian Fellowship over on Beaver Street, and their pastor, Steve Cole. So if you're the praying type, join me and lift them up. Father, thank you for a beautiful Flagstaff Day. Thank you for where we live, for where we are today. Thank you for how we can see you in nature. And thank you so much for our friends that share so much in common as we all look to you at the center, Christ, that meet at Flagstaff Christian Fellowship. God, thank you so much for Steve and his friendship and Marla and just all they've been to this community and the lives they've impacted. Thank you for his incredible knowledge and your words. And thank you for his willingness teach. And we just pray that we will always draw close to that congregation, our family over there, as we're all drawn close to you. And we pray for all the churches in town as well and around the world. We thank you for the giant family that we're a part of. Thanks for your love as a father. And we pray also today, God, as we open your words, as always, will you please open our mind and our eyes and our ears for what you might have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I know some of you were probably maybe instantaneously disappointed when you didn't see Kyle and Greta here. We're so blessed to have them. But then you were probably amazed at the musicians that we had up here. The way that works is we have a giant bucket filled with young, hipster, phenomenally talented musicians. And so one set goes, we just dip in there and we'll pull some of those. Now, some of them wear Gilligan's Island hats. Max. I doubt Max even knows what Gilligan's Island is. But that happened. So here's the thing for me, this is kind of it's hard for me to be here today because right now at this moment, my two oldest children are playing their soccer games. And that's so much more important than any of you are being here. It's driving me crazy because I want to know how they're doing so I can be yelling at them. It's actually not true, I do that. I love them and encourage them. But the reason my heart is definitely with them right now. And I am trying to survive. A Sunday is pretty crazy without Kyle and Greta here. It is kind of unbelievable how much they do and we're all just trying to piece it together. Hopefully you won't experience much of that. But except me doing 1999, holding the mic. Hopefully that'll be the extent of it. Here's the thing, though. It's a great weekend of sports, right? What was the greatest event in sports this weekend?
Champions League.
I love someone on the front row. Who said Champions League? Okay, whoever said horse racing can just get up and leave. No, Champions League is great. I'm a big Barcelona fan, but I'm a bandwagon fan in the sense that I just became a Barcelona fan last year when I visited there a few months ago. And it was really great, though, because they won this historic run. They won the treble, which I'm sure you're all really passionate about. The three, they won the Spanish League and the Spanish Cup. And yesterday, the Champions League 3-1. And it was actually a historic day for horse racing. Since 1978, the Triple Crown winner, which is great, which is cool. Here's how I'm going to transition to something that matters. One of the players from Barcelona, after they went to Berlin and they hoisted the Champions League trophy in glory, he tweeted on his Twitter account, Vini, Vidi, Vici. You know the Latin phrase, famous from Caesar? We came, we saw, we conquered. Are you familiar with this? This is what he proclaimed, that they came and they conquered Berlin in the Champions League with such strength and passion. I loved it. But here's the thing. We're going to talk today about one central element of that. He says that they came and they saw and they conquered. And if you haven't been with us, we started a new discussion a couple weeks ago, about the senses. And we've been taking a close look at how we can look throughout the whole narrative of the Bible and look at certain metaphor of senses and how we experience God. So in the past couple weeks, we've looked at the five senses. We started out by looking at the sense of taste. And I started there because I thought it would be the most challenging. But we looked at the idea of what it means to taste and see that the Lord is good, as the psalmist proclaim. We could also what it would be like to be the taste that changes the world. We're called to be the salt, or the flavor is really a better translation probably of the world. The art that Christians put out, the creativity, the love, the world-changing presence of the church should taste good, should be the flavor of the world. And last week, we looked at the sense of, what came after that? Say smell, which I thought would be even harder, right? But we looked at the aroma of Christ, and we looked at the sense of smell, and how smell goes straight to the brain, and we talked about the fact that when we are the aroma of Christ, hopefully we shoot straight to the brain of the world, that there is this essence of which our love and our creativity and the essence of who we are as a church, as a community, global and diverse, will actually affect the world. Today we're going to look at, as I've already mentioned, sight. Now I think this one's a little bit lower hanging fruit in terms of amount of references in the Bible. I mean, you can probably from the top of your head think about the importance of the metaphor of seeing. In fact, it's not even just limited to biblical references. We use language about seeing or blindness all the time. Can you see what I'm saying to you? We always use this kind of language. We think about and live in a culture that's shaped by the metaphor of sight or blindness. And so I was trying to think of stories that would illustrate this, as always. And one of them I was thinking of, I shared a couple years ago, probably both of these stories actually, you put up with me a few years ago. But I was downtown with my family, and I'm a pretty thoughtful person, polite, pretty much just a balanced overall socialite. And as we were at this kind of amphitheater for family movie night, I was being self-aware and conscious and polite, and I had stood up to shuffle my young children around, and I realized that I might be blocking somebody's view. So I turned to the lady behind me and said, "Hey, I'm so sorry. I'll be done in just a second. Am I blocking your view? Can you see?" And Marcus kind of elbowed me and I said, "Excuse me, ma'am. Can you see? I don't mean to be blocking your way." And she said, "Well, I'm blind." And I said, so you can't see me. So that's I'm gonna go walk over here and pretend like that didn't happen. And Marco was elbowing me because it was obvious that this was someone who had blindness. She had a dog with her and a cane and had these sunglasses on. And yet somehow that escaped me, and I forcefully made her tell me if she could see or not. That doesn't feel very good. She was very gracious about it, thankfully. The other thing I was thinking about with sight was, this was probably 2 or 3 years ago. Colt was not me. He was probably 5 or 6 years old. And I know I told this story right after it happened because I thought it was so great. He went to his pediatrician appointment, and when he went in there, they checked his eyes. And I was surprised that, you know, they have all these crazy new laser technologies where they can take pictures of your eyes, but they also still give the old test with the kind of the giant E and the letters and the numbers and all that stuff. And so Colt, when he was asked to do this, because this is kind of the first time we were going to get a reading on if this kid could see, because he was old enough to be able to know his letters instead of shapes and stuff. So I said, okay, there was a nurse in the front, and she said, pointed at line 8, she said, "Can you read this line?" And Colt, and he's a pretty shy kid, he was looking there, and he just said, "No, I can't read that." So, you know, my heart's racing a little bit. I go, "Oh, man, he can't read line 8. What does that mean? He's never going to get into Harvard." And I don't mean that. And then they said, "Okay, can you read line 7? And he looked at it and squinted, and he said, "I really can't." I said, "Okay, what about line 6? And I just kept going up the chart. And so Mark and I were looking at each other like, "Oh my gosh, this kid can't see anything," which means he inherited Mark's eyes. And as they went up the list, they get to the line of 2, and they say, "Can you read this?" He says, "No." And they point at the giant E, and they said, "Can you read that?" And he said, "E." They said, "Can you just try line 5 again? Just try." He looked at it and squinted really hard, and he said, "Kulajwasa." He thought he had to read each line. He misunderstood. He actually has perfect vision. He's the only one in our family that has 20/20 vision. He just can't read jumbled letters and make a word out of them. So I thought that was pretty good. Sight is a huge, huge part of our life. Now, the reason we're doing this discussion at all, just to review a little bit, is the idea that we want to have some sort of contact or a connection point with the idea that the Christian worldview or having a relationship with Jesus, whatever vernacular you want to use, has some sort of experiential element to it, or else it has no value. There has to be some way in which we experience God. And the senses is the way in which we experience things. We have no memories, we have no story without the 5 senses, in essence. And so that's one of the reasons we're looking at it, is how do we experience God in those things? But more importantly, and this is the key thing, how does the narrative, the whole narrative scripture, use the metaphor of sight? Now, sight to me was almost overwhelming with all the metaphors and different examples of the prophets, the Old Testament, the New Testament, all the different times the Bible uses seeing or sight to talk about our connection to God. But really, it was low-hanging fruit to pick out the story that I want to zoom in on. It's actually one that I was shocked when I opened my Bible that I haven't talked about at the comments. I had a long career in Young Life, and I love to talk about this story. And I guess because of that, I just assumed I always talked about it here, but I looked at my Bible, there's no squiggly notes because I always just make little squiggly notes whenever I'm talking about something. But it's the story in John chapter 9 of the blind man. There's many blind men that encountered Jesus in his ministry that we have record of. And this one is probably the most famous. It's kind of unique because it entails an entire chapter. All of John 9 is one narrative, and it's really a beautiful narrative. It's dramatic. It has character developments. It's layered into six different scenes. It has this incredible character that we're going to meet in a minute. But before we do, I want to talk a little bit about his experience of blindness. I Googled cool facts about sight right before I walked up here. I was back in the back just Googling these things. And it said, this blew me away, 39 million people right now are blind and have no vision whatsoever. And I can't imagine what that experience is like. Now, most of you, or maybe you're blind here today, and we're so glad you're here, we can learn from. Most of you who know blind people know that there's a gift in all sorts of these things. In fact, one of the things I've really enjoyed in Scotland at the University of St. Andrews is the theology of disability, even if disability is the right term to use. Because no matter what it is, if it's a community of those that can't hear or can't see, what we've learned is those communities bring a different angle to life that actually all of us could learn from. There's an essence in which part of the danger wading into the waters of even the story we're going to look at today is the assumption that it's all horrible that someone's blind. Whereas if you know someone dearly that's blind, you know that they may see on a deeper level lots of things, which is really cool. But think about sight itself, losing it or having it. The eyes and sight are an incredible feature. I mean, most of you know most of this. I've heard some of these things before, but you know, your brain is highly connected to your sight. And I think this is really important because when we talked about the connection of how smell is completely attached to that section of the brain, sight is even more so. 80% of your brain is used when you're viewing things. Your eyes are constantly moving. In fact, this is one of the only things that in science yet we cannot do an eye transplant because of its complexity of the optic nerve. There are 1 million very sensitive nerves that connect your eyeball to your brain. So we can't just put someone else's eyeball in there because it's too intricate, it's too beautiful, it's too perfect. And the way the brain works is unbelievable. As you probably know, that things come into your eyeball and are actually received upside down, almost like a concave or convex mirror. You've seen that in science. And your brain actually flips the image so that you see things right side up in our world. But here's what's really cool into this. If you put glasses on someone that flips the image of the whole world, after a certain amount of time, your brain will flip the image again. Isn't that amazing? The human brain will actually adapt so that no matter what information you're actually receiving through your optic nerve, your brain will interpret it and you'll start to see right side up again, even though the image is flipped. That's the power of the connection of the eyes and the brain. It's a pretty amazing gift. All of that to say, this particular person that encounters Jesus in John 9 had none of that, and he had none of that from birth. Turn with me to John chapter 9 if you'd like, or we'll have it up on the screen. This is how it begins. This is talking about Jesus. It says, as he went along, he saw a man blind from birth. Now, I want to take a quick stop here because one thing that I want to point out from this very simple sentence in John's narrative is something that is thematically true about the person of Jesus Christ. He seems to always see the marginalized. This is what he does. If he's at the pool, Bethesda, he sees the paralyzed man. He sees the women who are on the outside of society or put down. Jesus had the ability of always seeing the hurting and the marginalized. And that might have something to do with the sight that Jesus had, something that we should probably emulate. So he sees this man born blind from birth. It says that his disciples asked him, page turn, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Now, it's interesting because in the narrative of John, this is actually the first time in a couple chapters that the disciples or the close friends of Jesus have even showed up. All of a sudden, they show up with this very important theological question. Now, it's a very valid question if you live in the first century or maybe even perhaps today. They're saying, okay, there's something wrong. We see maybe the problem of evil or the problem of suffering. There's something wrong with this person's sight. Whose fault is it? What is the source of this problem? This is a huge theological question. Actually, I'm appalled and shocked often at the answers that Christians and the church give to these sorts of things. But see, they were speaking from a first century perspective. And back then, people really did have a debate about where physical infirmities came from. In fact, we know this even from the Bible. Did you know that the Bible itself actually debates itself on this topic? And that's probably part of the story why these Jewish followers of a rabbi were asking this question, because you see, even in the Ten Commandments, when it talks about the blessings of following God or not, it says that those who don't, God's curse will go from generation to generation after them. It's that it's almost if parents sin, their children will pay for it. But then later in the Jewish texts, in Jeremiah and Isaiah and other places, the other side of the coin is thrown out. So no, that's not true. Children don't pay for the sins of their parents. So did you ever know that the Bible actually sometimes debates itself? Is that the sort of thing you're familiar with when you think about this library of books? I mean, think about Jesus and the way he challenges the text. You have heard it said, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, but I tell you, he's quoting Scripture, and he in Scripture is saying, that's not really how it should be. There's a dialogue and a tension even within the biblical text about very difficult topics, which should lead us to a place, one, of humility, and two, of mystery. There's some mystery to these kinds of questions. But I love Jesus' answer here. I lost my page. He says to them, neither this man nor his parents sinned, said Jesus, but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. He basically says it's not about this guy's sin, and it's not about his parents' sin. We even read in the rabbinical texts, things like the Talmud, we read that Jewish rabbis used to teach that you could sin in the womb, and they pointed to a story of Jacob and Esau wrestling in the womb, saying you could sin in the womb, and maybe that's how you're born with sin, or your parents' sin caused it. Jesus is saying neither this man did it, nor his parents. He's not saying that they're without sin. He's answering their question. This blindness is not because of someone's sin. This blindness is because of what's about to happen, namely the works of God. There's another really cool place just for reference if you want to read more. In Luke 13, Jesus gives a very explicit, what we call theodicy, or response to the problem of evil or pain, when he talks about these strange events, almost like news items of the day, where a tower of Siloam had fallen on 18 people and killed them. And people were saying, what did they do wrong? And Jesus said, they weren't any more guilty than anyone else around there. We all have this condition of sin. And there was this other poor Galileans that were brutally murdered, and Pilate did horrible things with them, and the blood mixing it together. And they said, what did they do wrong? And Jesus is saying, they didn't do anything wrong compared to anyone else. And the reason this bothers me or it's important is because sometimes something like Haiti happens, and somebody like Pat Robertson goes on television and says the reason this earthquake took so many lives is because the people in Haiti worshiped voodoo. That's not true. The earthquake happened because of geological reasons. The earth needed to stretch its back. People died. We live in a world of real danger. That's part of what possibly is the best possible universe, where courage or true unconditional love could happen. And it's really important, because people who suffer is not just people in Haiti. People who suffer is right here on this stage and right here in this room. And it's real easy and okay to shake our fists at the heavens. God can handle it. But to remember that it's not sin necessarily that brings pain or evil or destruction into life. There's a bigger, broader mystery at play. And it has something to do with what Jesus said, so that God's glory can be revealed. This is a hard topic. In fact, this is one that I'm writing my dissertation on right now, along with kind of evolutionary pain and trying to struggle with theodicies of these things. And there is no easy answer, but there is a very central theme throughout this entire narrative of a dichotomy of good and evil, good weeds and bad weeds. And it will all be sorted out, and someday we will look back with a different perspective on now. But let's be careful that we don't blame people when natural evil takes place. Sorry, too much of a tangent. He goes on and says, as long as it's day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Jesus still speaking. Night is coming, and when no one can work, while I'm in the world, I am the light of the world. And this is John. Remember, old man, his much anticipated message to the world, the Gospel of John and the Christian communities, his themes of the I ams, I am the light of the world, all these things. You have to also remember the context, because right before this is really important. What has happened in John chapter 8 is he has revealed very explicitly his I am statement. Before Abraham was, I am. This was a huge, explicit claim to be the God of the universe. And that was right after John 7, where he has watched the priest take water from the pool of Siloam at the Feast of Tabernacles and dump it over the altar. And he stands up and yells in front of everyone, if anyone's thirsty, come to me, and I'll fill them up and make them streams of water. So the context is all flowing through here. And this is what's interesting. Here's where the miracle happens. After saying this, that he's the light of the world, he spit on the ground, made some mud with the saliva, and put it on the man's eyes. Go, he said to him, wash in the pool of Siloam. This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. Does anything strike you as weird in this story of this person being healed? Besides the mud pie and spit. This man, who we don't know the name of, does nothing. He's sitting beside the road. He never says a word. Jesus never asks if he believes. He never asks if he thinks he can do this. He never asks if he wants to be healed. Some of the great questions that God asks in other places. In this particular place, many, many commentaries have noted that this is actually a physical picture of what grace is. There's nothing earned here. This guy just, it just happens to him. He's just given something from Jesus, and it's very bizarre. He spits in the ground and makes mud. And the early church fathers, Irenaeus and Origen and Augustine, they spent a lot of ink or whatever, papyrus, wasted paper, trying to figure out if there's some sort of theological significance to this. Was this some sort of reference back to that early creation narrative about man coming from dust? Is this a recreation of this man's eyes from the dust? That's all possible, but it's probably more likely, because we know a little bit more about first century Palestinian medicine, this was more of a medical practice. This was common for people to use spit and mud as a salve or some sort of treatment for injury. So it would not have been that weird to anyone in that century, but it's really, really strange to us. So Jesus does this. He goes to the pool called Sent, and this is kind of interesting because it's really translated probably the Sent One, and that's the name that John often uses for Jesus. He's the Sent One. Jesus is, remember when God speaks, Jesus comes out. And for him in his gospel, the Sent One is the way he talks about Jesus. Some translations, which I like, call this the pull of missionary. The pull of the missionary, Christ. And a lot, it hasn't escaped the church thinkers throughout time, but this is a lot like baptism. You go to the waters, and this is the same pool, by the way, in John 7, where they brought that water from in the Feast of Tabernacles. It's a holy place with this holy water, and you go to the holy waters of the great missionary Jesus and wash, and you will be able to see. So there's this undertone from the late first century that John is writing in about the Christian practice of baptism. But we got to move on. And I'm just going to paraphrase some of this because it's the whole chapter. After this, he tells all of his neighbors and friends about it, and they have some crazy questions. They're saying, this can't be the same guy. And I love to point out in this passage that they can't even recognize this man. The only difference is he can see, whereas before he couldn't. I'm assuming his behavior changed. He's probably walking more confidently around. He probably has a different look. And so they're actually arguing about if this is the same person. And I think there is a spiritual metaphor here. When we're washed, when we see, when we're connected to God's unconditional grace and love, shouldn't it be that we're irrecognizable from our previous self? I think that's a pretty cool thought, but we're going to keep skipping along. He says, "How then were your eyes open?" His friends asked, and he replied, "The man they called Jesus made some mud and put it on my eyes, and he told me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' So I went, and I washed, and I could see." And guess what? This probably is a literature reference to Vini Vidi Vici. Julius Caesar had already said this. This was translated often in Latin, and he's basically saying, "I went, which is Vidi, I washed, and then I could see, Vidi." Where do we get the word video from? And I think people would have caught the reference in the first century. He's using basically three phrases, like Caesar did, to sum up the entire experience that he's had with Christ. I washed and I can see. And in his case, conquering isn't the end. Seeing is the end goal. And I don't think that was lost on that audience. And it's also interesting here that he calls him the man they called Jesus. And I want to start here by pointing out how unbelievable this blind man is. In fact, one commentator that I really like, his name is Dale Bruner, he calls this the man who always tells the truth. Because throughout this entire chapter and narrative, six different scenes, which we're not going to look at all of them, this man always tells the truth. Even if it's going to cost him everything, even in the face of great adversity, and he's very thoughtful about the way he tells the truth. But what's really beautiful is in the beginning, Jesus starts as the man, and we're going to see what's called an escalating Christology throughout the chapter. It's something we saw in John chapter 4 with the Samaritan woman. She also begins with saying, "How can you, a Jewish man, talk to me?" And then a little bit later, she says, "I can clearly see that you're a prophet." And then a little bit later, she goes as the first missionary leader and leads an entire village to say, "This is the Savior of the world." Her view of Christ escalated like a crescendo. This is a theme of John. It's something we're going to see with this heroic man who was healed. After this is the first court scene that I'll skip through, but the Pharisees investigate him. And there we already start to see some red flags come up with what we call the serious, or the Pharisees. This was done on the Sabbath, and they're curious about what's going on, and they ask him different things. And at the very end, the man says, when they ask him, they say basically, "What's your opinion of who this is?" This is down in verse 18 or 17. The man replied, "He is a prophet." We're seeing the escalation. And he doesn't say, "I think he might be the prophet because he did these things." There's a certain strength in this man's tongue. As he's questioned by the most important people of the day, he says, "Well, the guy's got to be a prophet." says they still did not believe that he'd been blind and had received his sight, and so they sent for the man's parents. Is this your son, they asked? Is this the one you say was born blind? How is it that he can now see? And his parents basically, just for time's sake, they basically kind of weasel out of it and say, oh, we don't really know, you can ask him, which is, I think, ironic. They say you can ask him because here's what they do when they send him back in verse 24. A second time they summon the man, and we're back in the court scene, who had been blind, and they said, give glory to God by telling the truth. Ironic to the one who always tells the truth. They said, we know this man is a sinner. What this is not is a question. We're starting to see the development of the characters, the bad guys in the story, which are often in John, these serious religious leaders, those who have to be right. In fact, one of the things that's interesting here is they said, we know that this man is a sinner. John uses this little device. He uses eyes 9 times throughout this chapter, but every time he's talking about the Pharisees, over and over and over again, out of their mouth, they keep saying, we know this. So what we see here is this authentic character in the healed person, and yet we see the right ones on the other side. And this is something that I think is an important theme that John's trying to get out about seeing and truth and a clear reality of who we are. If you're the sort of person that always needs to be right, you need to look clearly at who you are, because in this narrative, those are the bad guys. So this is one of the most beautiful passages in the whole thing. He replied, whether he is a sinner or not, I don't know. One thing I do know, I was blind, but now I see. You're familiar with Amazing Grace that uses this line. Hopefully this line has stuck out to you in this passage before, because it is a beautiful picture of the beautiful message of the Christian worldview, that Christianity is unbelievably simple. A child can know God deeper than we can know God. You don't have to be a great apologist or go to Oxford or know all sorts of theologies or even be right about a lot of stuff. If you could say, there's one thing that I know, I was blind and now I see. That is Christianity in a nutshell. That is poetry. That is John, who was a great leader in the church, putting in a narrative form how wonderful the gift of Jesus is, that we can all say in many contexts, yada, 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 I don't know. There's only one thing I know. I was blind, but now I see. Don't miss that. That's a gift of this whole thing. From there, he goes on to say that I've already told you, and he challenges them, and the Pharisees get very angry, the serious people. He starts telling them that if you want to know the details, you can be his follower. And then in 34, in their anger, they replied, you were steeped in sin at birth. How dare you lecture us? And they threw him out. The anger of the right ones surfaces here. The theologians who know all the truth ahead of time, who have no space for an experience to come into their worldview, end up throwing this man out of the synagogue. They excommunicate him. They toss him out. One of the things I love about this is in this whole conversation, it's almost as if Jesus was on trial, not the man. They're asking him questions in absentia without Jesus there about how he could do this on the Sabbath and break the rules. As you know, Jesus loved to almost challenge. It's almost like he chose to heal on the Sabbath just to drive these people crazy, to get to the point that it's not about the rules, it's about changed lives. It's about human hearts redeemed and restored and new vision and those kind of things. Well, they kick him out. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out. And when he found them, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? Who is he, sir? The man asked. Tell me so that I may believe in him. And Jesus said, you have now seen him. In fact, he's the one speaking with you. How cool is that? How many ways could Jesus have said that? He said, you have now seen him. He realizes that this guy has got his rods and cones turned on for the first time in his entire life. Shapes, colors, seeing, all that's coming in. And he's saying, who is the Son of Man? He goes, you're looking at him with those brand new eyes. He's standing right in front of you. This is the beautiful crescendo of what he thinks about Jesus, because here's his response. He says, then the man said, Lord, which was a very important term. This is meaning high master. This is the one that I believe in. I believe, and he worshiped him. See, this is not the first time or the last time in John that Jesus receives worship as if he is the God of the universe. He doesn't turn and say, oh, no, don't worship me. He receives that worship because this guy has gone from saying, yeah, this is a man named Jesus, to standing bravely in front of the courtroom and saying he's a prophet, to now saying, Lord, I believe, I worship you, this God. That's quite a transformation for the one who always tells the truth. Jesus said, for judgment I have come into this world so that the blind will see and those who see will become blind. Some Pharisees who were with him heard him say this and said, "What, are we blind too?" And Jesus said, "If you were blind, you would not be guilty of sin. But now that you claim you can see, your guilt remains." It's an ironic bookend to the beginning of chapter 9. He's saying, if you were blind, you wouldn't be guilty of sin. That's the irony of the opposite of what verse 1 was insinuating. He's saying, there's nothing sinful about being blind. There's something sinful about claiming you're not blind. So what? What's the point of all this? Well, one of the things that I like about how it ends there is it makes it very clear that this story is not actually supposed to teach us that every blind person should be healed by God. There was a lot of other blind people in the day. Many commentators from Augustine early on throughout centuries through the Reformation have noticed from the very beginning when it says that the man was born blind, that that man is us. We are all blind. And that the glory of God, the works of God that would be revealed that day to be kept in the canon of Scripture and shape the Western and Eastern world through the passing on of this story, which would be a great work of God, is that all of blindness, spiritual blindness, which this is about, can be changed in Jesus and we can have sight. So here's the so what. We need to do some personal ophthalmology. The question is, can we see? Are we blind or do we see? It's a very difficult one to answer, especially if you're someone who's been following Christ for some amount of time. Because the easy answer is, of course I can see, I know Jesus. And that's the perfect childlike answer. It's true. If you're thinking in terms of the way that I see is because I have escalated a Christology, I have seen who Jesus is, then you're right. You do see. But if you're saying I can see because I'm right, because I have my theology together, then you should be challenged very critically by this chapter. I'm going to tread lightly here because I don't want to, I hate getting political. I think politics can divide communities. But this last week, you can't have escaped the huge Bruce Caitlyn Jenner thing. And I'm not going to make a political statement, so you don't have to get too tense. But I will say this. One of the things that struck me about social media with this very difficult situation is all the we knows that I saw come out. People posted article after article after article, and it was, to me, the thing that I was struck with, how many of them was, we know, and then this is how we should respond. And I'm not saying that they don't know. I'm not saying that I don't even have opinions on those things. I think they are important if they're relevant. But what I am saying is how quickly everyone jumped in to have the answer or the perfect article alarmed me a little, because I remember the words of James, the brother of Jesus, when he wrote after a dramatic conversion, before he was thrown to his death, saying his brother was God, his half-brother. He wrote those words that we should be slow to speak and quick to listen. And I thought this controversy was just good to highlight how quick we are to speak and slow we are to listen. There's many controversial, difficult things, and there are right answers. It's not all relative. There is truth, and we need to move towards those things, and there are times where we need to speak. But let us be a people, if we truly see and aren't the we know people, who are very slow to speak and very quick to listen. I'm saying this with a hard heart because I'm terrible at this. I'm a blabby person. I'm very quick to speak. If you've ever been around me at a dinner table, pick a topic. I've got a lot to say about it. It's probably obnoxious and wrong because this verse challenges me. I shouldn't be a right person or a we know person. We need to be people who listen and see. So personal ophthalmology, how are we doing on that? Here's the last little thought that I thought would close it off. I like thinking about our vision, seeing the truth of who Jesus is, the hope, his unconditional love, but I really like this idea. Have you ever thought about, in the senses and sight, about God's sight? Obviously, we don't have to ask if God can see, but what does God see? One of the things I'm fascinated with as a dad of small children is how much of my life is consumed with phrases like, "Dad, watch this. Mom, check it out. Dad, are you watching? Mom, are you looking at this?" Children want to be seen. And what I love to tell my kids is, I'm always watching. You don't even have to ask. I'm watching. I'm thrilled. It's killing me to, unless your soccer game's during church, then I won't watch. Other than that, I'm always watching. I want to be there. I want to see it, right? Here's the thing. I want you to hear this very, very clearly. This is the one thing that I want you to know deeply about God's vision. He sees you. And I mean that in a deep metaphorical way. I think we all have a need to be seen, that childlike thing. We need to be seen, not just seen externally how our world interacts. We need to be seen deeply for who we are. Listen to me. God sees you. But here's the better news. His vision is a beam of love. He is gazing at you with parental, deep, unconditional love. See, I assume that there are children that grow up in homes where they don't want to be seen, where they hide. And I assume that there's wounded hearts in here, like mine and yours, that sometimes we don't want to be seen. And the idea of God looking at us, in fact, I've met people and sat across coffee from people that saying, I can't believe in God because I just don't want to be seen all the time. And I go, oh, I wish you knew the gazing beam of love that God is shining on you. I wish you knew how good it would feel to just say, God, are you watching? God, are you looking? Yeah, I'm always watching because I love you. See, I think that sight is a transformational beam. I think that vision changes who we are. And that leads me to my very, very final point. When that beam of love comes into us, there's one other analogy that Jesus talks about that I love in Matthew and a couple of places he points out, that we should then become the light of the world. What's cool about that is Jesus says he's the light of the world. And then he goes on to say, you're going to be the light of the world. A city on a hill, a lamp that can't be hidden. So that those will see your good works in Christ and they will go light. And all the senses are coming together because the senses make us experience God and we taste and see that the Lord is good. We smell the aroma of Christ. We see the beauty of God and the transformation happens and all of a sudden we are the light of the world. We are the aroma of Christ. We are the flavor that gives everything. And when we are light and all those things, then the community shines. I've told you this before, that the early church, they referred to the church as the moon. Because they looked up and they saw it reflecting the light of the sun and said, that's what the church should be. It just takes the light of the sun and reflects it back to there. That's why that's part of our logo is a little moon. That represents the idea that we're supposed to just reflect the light of God back to the world. We're going to share communion as we always do. And at communion, one of the things that's so beautiful about this sacrament, one of the other sacraments that's so beautiful is the baptism that we saw the blind man go through, which is such a tangible reality and a deep metaphor. The same thing is true of this sacrament. The way we celebrate it, if you're visiting with us, is an open table. We believe everyone is open at the table of the Lord. We also celebrate it as an optional time. There are many reasons you would choose, and that's okay to not partake. But we do invite you to experience Christ in the senses. That's what sacrament is. And there is great mystery here. You can't theologize about it too much because we take wine and we take crackers and they represent in some way the body of Christ broken for us, the full picture of the unconditional love of God. His blood spilled, the fulfillment of that awful animal killing sacrifice system. Stop that, I'll be the perfect sacrifice and my blood will absolutely, truly wipe away sin. And somehow in the sacrament, we take those into our senses and we do it together in a community. And what we do is we receive grace. Think back to this blind man who does nothing. This is an opportunity to come here after a week. If you're like me, throughout the week, I just get worse and worse oftentimes. And when I come to the communion table, I'll always sneak around the back and take it myself. When I come to the communion table, it's the chance to just go, I'm the blind man. I'm blind, and I need again the grace of Jesus to see me, to see my marginalized self, and just reach out and bring healing. That's what communion is. So let me pray over these elements, and if you'd like, you can partake during this song. God, thank you for, again, John and his gift of a book that has survived time to us this day, and the story of this man who always tells the truth. And I'm thankful for this nameless man to us who you know his name, of course, Lord. Thank you for his understanding of you, how it grew until he realized that you were worthy of worship. Because of your grace, because of your love. And God, at the communion table today, we want to experience that kind of coming and experiencing and seeing. We want to take of your elements. And I pray over these crackers, this bread, this wine, this grape juice, Lord, that you will be present in a very real way as you have been for so many years, for so many of our brothers and sisters. And Lord, as always, collectively as a family, sitting around the table, Lord, we ask you to please forgive us of our sins. Lord, we don't want to be like the serious Pharisees. We want to admit to you that we are blind. Forgive us of that. Heal us. Wash us clean in your pool. Wash us clean in your blood. And Lord, all of us collectively, even if it's difficult, we receive that unconditional love. We take it. We love your grace. We thank you that we can't out-sin it. And Lord, we do it together. We thank you for this community. We thank you for the fun we have, the tears we share. We thank you for the body that you've given us that is you. We love you and pray that we are aware of you in this time.